Mystery Mondays. Mystery Mondays. Mystery Mondays. Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays. Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Mystery Mondays.
Thank you. Game of Thrones, baby.
Nice.
Game of Thrones, baby.
Ode to Game of Thrones.
Game of Thrones.
Or Mystery Mondays, is it? Is it Game of Thrones? Or is it Mystery? To be fair, there's actually quite a lot of cool mysteries in the Game of Thrones universe. Do you like ever hear about like the what do they call them? The deep ones?
The deep ones.
The deep ones.
George R. R. Martin, obviously like all authors, is heavily influenced by many different authors himself and literary works. And he clearly quite likes Lovecraft because the deep ones are almost like they're supposed to be these like ancient, almost like amphibious men used to like rule Westeros. And there's like rumors that like sometimes they still like come out of the ocean and like steal people into the sea and stuff.
Whoa.
Pretty creepy. And it's like Old Town, which you know in House of the Dragon, you know the High Towers.
Yeah.
So they're like the you know Alicent Hightower and Otto Hightower and basically the bad guys.
Or at least, the High Towers.
Or at least in my eyes. yeah, like nobody knows who built Old Town. It was already like there, like the tower of Old Town was like already there. Mm. And apparently it was built by this like slimy, almost like black, like stone. And a lot of people think that the deep ones.
The deep ones built it.
The deep ones.
I love it how you know like so much about any kind of fantasy things. Like if you watch something, you get like balls deep.
Oh, balls deep, mate. Mm. I can't help it, man.
It's good. Like because the more you know about all of the background of it, like the richer it makes the story.
100%.
You know, the more you can indulge yourself within the story, within the world.
And obviously
the writer like deliberately will like put like nods and references to stuff that unless you know it that well, it will slip by you. But if you know it really in depth, you realize it's a really cool reference to something or like a nod or like an Easter egg, as they call it, and you're like, oh, I know what they're referencing.
The Easter egg.
Yeah, I know what they're referencing. Or even like things like, even things like, the different swords. So like Daemon Targaryen, who's obviously played by Matt Smith, the new one, like he's got this sword called Dark Sister.
Ah.
And I think that during Aegon's conquest, like when the Targaryens took over, that was, I think it was it Rhaena or Rhaenys? Rhaena, I want to say. Who was like, one of Aegon's wives, who was also one of his sisters. That was like her sword, but she was like the one that was like the super warrior badass one, basically like the Xena, but with like white hair. And that's Daemon's sword and stuff like that. It's just pretty cool, isn't it?
That is cool. So that wasn't in the House of the Dragon then, so you don't see any of those.
Dark Sister is Daemon's sword. So you know that.
Sister whose sword it was originally.
Yeah, because obviously they're like the descendants. By the time the House of the Dragon, obviously the Targaryens have like been like in charge of Westeros for like hundreds of years. And so that was like the original Aegon's conquest. So there wasn't like a united kingdom of Westeros like back along when the Targaryens invaded. There was like lots of small kingdoms. So like the north, you know how like Eddard Stark in like the beginning of Game of Thrones, he's like Lord and Warden of the North. Mm-hmm. Well, they would have just been like King of the North.
King of the North.
And then like the King of the West would have been like the Lannisters or whatever. And then, you know, all of that stuff.
So does it annoy you a little bit that they didn't go back a bit further for like the new series? Because they started about halfway through that book, didn't they?
Well, I think it would obviously be like too much to do in one go. I would like it I think it would be really cool if they made another series that was all about Aegon's conquest.
Yeah, because I would have thought it would have been cool to like start at the beginning. Do you know what I mean? And like do that as the first one and then like, you know.
Let me just try and think. I think it's like, It's somewhere like it's not like this isn't accurate at all, but it's about halfway through the Targaryen reign. Like if you think of like Game of Thrones, it's almost like the end of the Targaryen reign because obviously when we start Game of Thrones, it's a Baratheon on the throne. Mm. It's Robert Baratheon, isn't it?
Robert Baratheon.
At the beginning of House of the Dragon, Viserys Targaryen is the king on the Iron Throne, and then but if you wanted to do like a show which was like Aegon's conquest, which was when the Targaryens
that'd be sick.
Yeah, they came over, they fortified Dragonstone, which is obviously featured a lot in both Game of Thrones and House of the Dragon, because in Game of Thrones it's where Stannis Baratheon like lives. He's like the Lord of Dragonstone, and obviously in House of the Dragon it's where Rhaenyra and Daemon are residing, isn't it?
What's the place with the big hole and they like chuck people down the hole that's up in the tower?
The Eyrie, that's cool. Yeah, so the lords of that land are called House Arryn. House Arryn, and they were originally Andals. So you've got Andals and the First Men, and then you've got And then you've got like
The Angles and the Saxons.
Yeah. And then you've got like the blood of old Valyria. So obviously like it's like different people. So it's like the Valyrians are obviously like Targaryen. And the only like, there's the Valyrians and the Targaryens. I think they're the only two Valyrian houses like in the entire Westeros. You've either got either that or they're either descendants of First Men, which is what like the Starks are, or you've got the descendants of Andals, which is what like some other houses are, like House Arryn.
Mm. There you go. So Game of Thrones intro.
Boom.
And then just a random bit of knowledge.
Shocking knowledge.
But no, it just made me think, because obviously, yeah, as we went into it, there are actually loads of really cool mysteries in Game of Thrones. And it's like, you know, you were saying even about like House, like the Eyrie and House Arryn. There's like the myth of House Arryn is that when the Andals invaded Westeros, which was like thousands of years before the Targaryens invaded Westeros, apparently the Lord of House Arryn, like back in the day, they were like masters of these like giant falcons. So in my head, I almost like imagine like the giant eagles in Lord of the Rings.
Yeah, yeah.
And apparently like the Eyrie, because it's like the whole thing about the Eyrie, it's like it's impenetrable because basically they built the fortress on top of this massive mountain. So if they want to just like shut the gates off to the world, they just can. And it's like no army has ever successfully invaded. Mm. But obviously what he, and that was like the first men had that as well. But what he did is he just obviously just rode right to the top and then just like landed, and then just like rather than obviously having to go all through like up the mountain through the gates and everything, he like landed on this giant falcon.
Fly on the eagle.
But yeah, like a falcon. And if you remember, you might not remember, but like the sigil of House Arryn is like a falcon. But yeah,
there
so
you go.
But like nobody knows in modern days if like that's a real story or not, or if it's a myth. But let's face it, in the world of Game of Thrones there's like dragons and magic and stuff, so the idea of like a giant falcon isn't really that crazy. Well, let's face it, we've had like giant birds in real life, man. Those like giant teratorns and stuff that we talked about on Pandora's Box, and they were like legitimate
Teratorn.
Like you could have rid one of those. They were like the size of like small planes.
Imagine that. Instead of horses, you're just like flying around on eagles
on a giant teratorn.
That'd be sick.
Like Avatar.
Yeah,
that'd be awesome.
Oh man, yeah. But yeah, and also ironically as well, just to finish off before we get into today's mystery, it's ironic as well, because that's obviously how House Arryn conquered the Eyrie and became lords of the Eyrie, is by riding to the top on a giant falcon and landing and then basically taking over the castle from the inside. That's exactly how the Targaryens conquered the Eyrie as well, because when the Targaryens invaded Westeros, they obviously went about conquering all the different lands, some more peacefully than others. And
they flew on some falcons.
No, they obviously flew on dragons.
Oh, on dragons, I'm like, yeah. Okay.
And
of course.
And House Arryn just, it was just like, oh, we'll just shut our gates and no army can get through. And then apparently one day the queen just went out into the courtyard and, Vhagar, the most massive dragon in House of the Dragon.
Uh-huh.
No spoilers, but that last episode, guys, if you've seen it. Vhagar, who's the most massive dragon by the time of the House of the Dragon, he was just like, he was just literally like out in the freaking courtyard and, yeah, as I said, I can't remember her name 100%. I think her name was Rhaena or something like that. Because the thing is, there's lots. The Targaryen names get reused loads, so it can be confusing. Do you know what I mean?
So a different Rhaena.
I think that was like the name of the one I'm on about that had Dark Sister Daemon's sword as well, and she was just out in the courtyard with like the Queen's son, and was just like
handed over.
That's essentially what happened. I think she said something like a bit more like ominous and like menacing, so the kid wouldn't understand. She was like saying that she was gonna like take the boy for a ride on the dragon, like, do you want to come for a ride on the dragon? But the queen obviously saw it as in like, but it was basically, it's like, you hand me the kingdom now or
I'm taking your son on this dragon, I'm gonna drop him,
and yeah or the dragon's gonna eat him or something horrible is gonna happen, like, you know. So she was just like, and apparently she did take the boy for a ride on the dragon, and then when she came back, because the queen knew what the symbolism was of it, by the time she came back, so there was just like the crown of the Eyrie was just like laid out in the courtyard and that, with like all the other stuff. So it was just like, yeah, here you go. And then then the Targaryens just basically demoted everyone from being like the kings of their region to like the lords of the region, which is why they call them like wardens, don't they? You've got like the Warden of the North, Stark, the Warden of the West, Lannister.
So they kind of let everyone stay in power,
but just
they
you're didn't demoted like overpa- from like yeah, yeah but yeah, you're demoted from
that's
king
pretty
to
cool
lord.
Rather than like replacing people or putting their own people like as the heads of those like places.
Definitely, man. Yeah pretty cool. Anyway, welcome to Mystery Mondays, everyone. Hope you're having a good day out there, whatever you've been doing. It's Bullwinkle's turn for a mystery.
Week,
let me just get up some spooky ominous music. We just about half an hour before we started today, Drew just randomly started playing a little bit of Game of Thrones.
And it started on the keyboard. Yeah. And I was like trying it for ages, like that little riff that ding, 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 ding.
Yeah.
But I just thought this would be way easier on guitar. Guitar's my main instrument, not keyboard.
Yeah.
Not weird little, like.
I mean, it's beautiful.
Mini
keyboard. It's a beautiful little thing, isn't it?
It is beautiful. It's beautiful to play around with.
Oh, this is one that we haven't tried before. What's this one
like?
Oh, it sounds a little bit too like happy.
I was going to say a bit happy, yeah.
Let's try another one. What do you think, folks? Do you think that's too happy? Oh, wait a minute. Ooh, that's like a thunderstorm. Do you reckon that would work?
Cool. That works.
Yeah?
I like that.
It's called Dark Alley.
Ooh. Dark Alley.
Do you want to try this one?
Some nice ambience.
I've just noticed in Bullwinkle's camera that the alien's got the mic.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Got a guest this week.
The alien's turning for the mystery.
The alien's cool. Turn.
Mm-hmm. Right, Bullwinkle, over to you.
Okay. So, ladies and gentlemen, the mystery for today will be that of Jeanette Depalma.
I might eat a sandwich while you're telling this one.
Yeah, man.
Get cozy.
I'll turn down my mic so everyone doesn't hear my mastication. That's mastication.
Ooh. So, today we will be speaking about the murder of Jeannette Depalma, a girl who was 16 years old at the time of her murder.
Hmm.
She was born on August the 3rd, 1956, and lived with her seven siblings in their strong Christian household. She was a kind person who took part in a lot of community work targeted in helping drug addicts. She lived in an upper middle class lifestyle, and the area of which she lived in had zero or near to zero crime. Jeannette had told her mother that she was going to get the train to her friend's house, and subsequently left her house on Clearview Road, New Jersey. Once the parents found out that she hadn't arrived at her friend's house and didn't return home in the evening, they called the police and filed a missing persons report. It was strange for Jeannette not to turn up, as she was a teenager who followed her religion strongly and did not party, which is why her parents immediately knew something was wrong once she went AWOL. 6 weeks later, on September 19th, De Palma's remains were found atop a cliff inside of Springfield's Hoodale Quarry, after a local dog brought her decomposing right forearm and hand back to its owner.
Oh.
So that's how they even like found her. Some dog just like arrived back to its owner, thought it'd got like a stick or something, but yeah, got a decomposing arm. Pretty brutal.
Yeah.
Brutal.
Mm-hmm. According to several witnesses at the scene, De Palma's skeletal remains were surrounded by a series of strange and possibly occult objects. Descriptions vary, but the most commonly agreed upon account states that the remains were found in a coffin-shaped perimeter of fallen branches and logs, and inside this perimeter were several small makeshift wooden crosses. Some Springfield residents later claimed that De Palma's remains were found lying on a pentagram surrounded by mutilated animal remains. I think we've got a photo as well. On the second tab, if you could switch that, there should be like an outline of a sort of coffin. So that's the sort of description that they were, like, everyone that saw it. Because I think it was a bit of a public thing where everyone was kind of going up and being like, what's going on here?
The thing is, with all the crosses, that would almost make it out like it was almost like a Christian or like a extremist religious thing.
Mm. Mm. So is that her on the left as well of it? Like,
this lady,
I think
obviously.
It is.
That lady, yes.
Ah, oh, pretty yes. Young lady.
The Federal Bureau of Investigation.
Where was it? Right, so she was facing down, and by this point, her body was so decomposed that she could only be identified by her teeth. Law enforcement authorities have denied that any of this was true, however, and further controversy was aroused when it was discovered that the body had been found on a cliff known to locals for several decades as the Devil's Teeth.
Mm.
That does add a bit like of a creepy sort of undertone.
Yeah, if you get like mutilated anywhere with and it's like in a place that's named after like the devil.
Yeah. Just if it was like on Happy Hill, then maybe
it makes
be
it
a
clear that it was obviously was a deliberately like cult thing. Like they obviously picked that area deliberately. You know.
The Springfield Police Department began an investigation of De Palma's death after an autopsy could not reveal a cause of death. Her remains and clothing showed no evidence of bone fractures, bullet wounds, or knife strikes. No drug paraphernalia was found on or around her body, and for undisclosed reasons, the coroner suspected that strangulation was the cause of death, leading the Union County Prosecutor's Office to treat the case as an unsolved homicide. The coroner was also discovered an unusually high amount of lead in the remains. But no explanation was found for this occurrence either. That's another weird little detail. Mm. Just like found with loads of lead, like in her blood. Of course, everyone's got like a bit, but I think it for them to have made a note of that, it must have been pretty like abnormally high.
There is such a thing as lead poisoning.
Yeah, things were made out of lead a lot, weren't they? Like in back in today. I swear, was it even like kitchen utensils and things that they would
drains.
Make?
Drains.
Drains, and
so
yeah.
So you get your tap water, but be contaminated
with
lead. Yeah,
that's it, yeah.
Brutal.
Savage.
Early in the investigation, Springfield police received a tip regarding a homeless man living in the woods near the quarry. The man was known to locals simply as Red, and it was alleged that he had fled his campsite in the woods shortly after Depalma went missing. While this lead initially looked promising, the Union County Prosecutor's Office ultimately decided that Red had nothing to do with Depalma's death.
Okay.
Investigators continued to attempt to find leads, but due to a lack of tips from the public, along with inconsistent stories told to the police by her family, friends and peers, the case eventually went cold. So that, to be honest, apart from that, like, from what I was reading, there didn't seem to really be anyone that was shining out like, this could be the guy. Mm. I also find it a bit weird that they mention the fact that there was inconsistent stories from her, like, friends, family and peers. You would think if they wanted to, like, find out what was going on, that, you know, they would... Why were their stories inconsistent? You know what I mean?
Yeah. I want to know what that means.
Exactly.
Inconsistent stories.
Exactly.
You know, like, did they say that she left at different times?
Or was it like completely different? Around 2 weeks after the discovery of De Palma's remains, several newspapers, including the Newark Star-Ledger and the New York Daily News, began reporting that she may have been the victim of an occult sacrifice carried out by either Satanists or a local coven of witches who operated inside nearby Watchung Reservation. The coverage was spurred by reports that the body had been found surrounded by strange objects, and the theories of James Tate, the pastor of the Depalma's Family Assemblies of God Church. Rumours about the case set off a panic in several Union County communities, which were still recovering from the shock of the John List murders only 10 months earlier. So I think there must have been like a mass murderer going on just earlier before this as well.
John List.
So that's, to be honest, that's like the main bit of the death, but we'll go on to like the aftermath. And there's this newspaper, or I don't know if it's like an internet website. I'm not entirely sure how it started, but it's called Weird NJ, Weird New Jersey. So they're sort of a website that would report on anything that was a bit strange going on in New Jersey.
Like the Jersey Devil. Have you heard about the Jersey Devil?
No.
That's creepy. Oh, that's going to be my next Mystery Monday.
Nice. I bet they probably reported on that as well.
Definitely would have.
Yeah. When the editors of Weird NJ began their own investigation into Jeanette's unexplained death, they were immediately met with resistance from local police, who claimed that all the files for the evidence relating to the Depalma case had been destroyed during flooding from Hurricane Floyd in 1999. Today, we finally know that to be untrue, which is quite a very... That's like a really strange detail.
What, so they've almost like had to release them then? Right now.
So, after a decade of working with Jeanette's nephew, Ray, and Weird NJ correspondent Jesse P. Pollack, who co-authored with Mark Moran the definitive book on the Depalma case, 2015's Death on the Devil's Teeth, Weird NJ has finally obtained copies of Jeanette's case file from Union County Prosecutor's Office. After years of denials from previous acting prosecutors, Pollack was able to consult with former UCPO Director of Communications Mark Spivey in 2019 to submit a detained file request under the New Jersey Open Public Records Act and the Freedom of Information Act.
Damn straight.
So originally they came out and they were like, all of these files have been destroyed, like there's no way we can even get them. And then we've now found out that they were there and they just were refusing to give
them
for like
withholding that information.
Years. Exactly, yeah. After nearly 2 years of delays due to COVID-19 and personnel changes, the UCPO finally released the bulk of Jeanette Depalma's case file to Pollack in February 2021, including crime scene photos that had previously been described by New Jersey police officials as missing. So it's a pretty recent like discovery that all this has come out. Until literally 2021, none of these photos were available. I believe we've also got some photos of the actual sort of crime scene photos up as well. They should be on another tab. I think the third tab, you'll just be able to see like some sort of small photos. So that's the actual like photos taken at the time of when it happened. You can click on them and like make them big screen as well if you'd like. The picture they paint is very clear. After a careful review of these photographs, Weird NJ feels confident that there was no occult activity involved in Jeanette's death. The alleged
crosses... Yeah, it doesn't
crosses,
really look that occulty, does it? Like not how, at all. How it was in the pictures. It just looks like kind of she's in the bushes.
The alleged crosses made from sticks and twigs and halo of stones that were supposedly found placed around Jeanette's body are completely absent from the crime scene photos. Also absent are any animal sacrifices that were long rumoured by whispering Union County residents to be near the remains. The closest object resembling a cross found near the remains are two rotten tree branches that had obviously fallen in that spot a long time before Jeanette had come to rest there. No arrows carved in trees or an altar of any scene are found in the photographs either. This, of course, makes what the press said about these photos in 1972 all the more confusing. An article that appeared in the September 29, 1972 edition of the Elizabeth Daily Journal entitled Girl Sacrificed in Witch Rite made the following claim. Investigation into the death of a 16-year-old Jeannette Depalma is focusing on elements of black witchcraft and Satan worship. A review of the death scene photos, according to reports, is leading authorities to believe the girl's death may have been in the nature of a sacrifice. Pieces of wood, at first thought to be at the scene by chance, are now seen as symbols. One searcher said two pieces of wood were crossed on the ground over her head. More wood framed from the body, like a coffin as well. So this is all like stuff that was coming out at the time of the death. Like all the press were saying it was a, you know, witch related.
Seems to be to me much. A bit like they were just being sensational about it, like try like kind of taking it a bit out of context and saying, oh, there's this like ritualistic murder. But like really, hearsay. To me, it looks like she was just like kind of placed in the bushes.
I think with a lot of things like this, it's like Chinese whispers, isn't it?
Yeah. Another thing which I found really interesting that I haven't actually written down, but I remember reading when I was like doing some research about this case. Apparently the police, when they were doing their investigation, actually hired, I think it was like an actual witch that they hired to like help them with the investigation, which seems weird.
Not really. You know, well, I don't know. It does for the time. Yeah. I know that back in the day, it was like quite commonplace. We've talked about other stuff before.
Yeah, like psychics and stuff.
Yeah, like it was quite commonplace. The police. Yeah, like 100 years ago, it was quite common for the police to like hire clairvoyants and psychics to help with murder cases and disappearances and stuff. But yeah, I mean, when did you say this happened? It wasn't that long ago, was it?
1972, I believe.
Yeah, yeah, so I mean, it was a fair while ago. 50 years ago.
The article was the first publication to link Jeannette Depalma's death with witchcraft and Satanism, but even a casual glance at the crime scene diagram drawn by UCPO investigator Glenn Owens shows that these supposed signs of black magic and Satan worship are tenuous at best. The two pieces of wood crossed on the ground over her head were actually parallel to Jeanette's body, with her right arm resting on the vertically parallel log and the other horizontal log lying just beyond her head. Both logs were much larger than Jeanette's entire body as well. The reports of logs framing Jeanette's body like a coffin are an exaggeration at best as well. As Owen's diagram shows, the branches fell in a way that roughly resembles an open rectangle and not that of a trapezoid as other newspapers reported. What is it? Trapezoid.
It's a trapezoid.
Trapezoid.
No, trapezoid.
That makes more sense. Trapezoid, as other newspapers reported in 1972. But considering this was a densely overgrown patch of woods, it's probably safe to say that the Hoodell Quarry was filled with countless other branches and yeah, exactly. Trapezoids, trapezoids, whatever you want to call it.
Tomato, tomato.
Yeah. The overgrowth itself is in another revelation as well. For years, Weird NJ has been told time and time again by retired Springfield PD investigators that the spot where Jeanette's body was found was a party spot, and that she likely overdosed there whilst partying with several other teenagers, all of whom presumably fled out of fear of prosecution instead of rendering her medical aid. The death scene photos tell an entirely different story, however. The spot of Jeanette's body also was discovered. No worries. Was discovered in much more overgrown than, yeah. Basically, it was a lot more overgrown than ever described. Right. Countless plants, bushes surrounding the remains. No evidence of a party.
Yeah.
Or any social gathering whatsoever. Which, once again, really strange.
Weird that, like, yeah, it was just initially reported like this, and it was just like so much further from the truth.
Yeah, it's almost like that the police are painting this certain picture because I don't know whether they can't be bothered to do the investigation or something.
I bet we'd be shocked.
They
at
blame
how much,
it on so yeah. on a certain thing, and then it's okay. We can forget about that, but we don't actually want to show you any of the evidence because it points to something, you know, man, completely different.
I bet we'd be shocked at how like common it was that things actually like that took place back in the day.
What happened now. We don't know who it is, so let's just leave it.
This is going to sound super, super ominous, and I don't want to go into it too much, but a family member of mine a long time ago, that's not alive anymore, confessed to a murder that my family are like pretty much convinced that they didn't actually commit, but that they did it for a certain reason, right? Which was like an honourable reason, right? And we are all convinced that he didn't do it. But in those days, if somebody just confessed, they didn't even bother looking into it. Like, they were like, case closed. Do you know what I mean?
Whoa.
They were like, they were just like, basically it's like case closed. But like, nowadays, you think they'd look into it more than that, but it was just like, well, we've got a confession, that's it, case closed.
Yeah.
But even that, that's like mental, isn't it? Because I remember when I first said that, I was like, oh, they didn't look into it like any more than that. But,
So he confessed and then went to like prison or got like
went to prison.
Yeah. God. Yeah. That's crazy, isn't it?
Yeah.
Like now it's like if the police are suspicious of the reason for a confession, they won't just take it and
they'll probably
like,
need more than just that.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? They'd like think, right, well why, you know, what, you know, they'd probably even think like, well, right, why would he possibly be confessing to this and stuff like that, or like, you know, if it doesn't seem like fit with his character and stuff like that, do you know what I mean, like right with his character. But it was almost just like, oh, case closed, nice, enough we don't have to do any more work on this one.
And it really,
time to go to the pub.
It feels like that as well, like on a completely different level, but like institutions and companies, like places that are set up in a certain way, normally aren't, that there's an element to them that are almost a little bit dehumanized, or like, you know, can't really be bothered to do it because it's not their problem. Like, you know, like, see, I'm finding at the moment just in a house thing, you know, it's like and like I got some stuff going on with our house, and like rang up the agency people, and because of the type of contract it is or whatever, it's like a non-managed contract, they're just like, yeah, sorry, you're gonna just have to talk to the landlord and like kind of blah blah blah. But like, you can tell that they really cannot be, that they don't want to talk to you about it, or they're just like, not my problem. Like, do you know what I mean? And like, I can imagine if like you're like, you know, a place like even the police force, if it's a murder or something like that, or it's gonna be like, you'd want them, or you'd expect them to be like, I'm going to put 1,000,000% into this until it's solved.
Yeah.
But I think a lot of the time it'll just be like, oh, you know, let's just sweep it under the carpet because we ain't got a clue. Like, and it's just like, it's done now, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And you don't want to think like that. You think, you know, you think that there'd be way more like of a human element to it. But, you know.
What seems to be like a really common theme in like all of the murder mysteries that we've done on Mystery Mondays and stuff, is that there always seems to be quite like bad police work in these mysteries.
Yeah,
but I feel like this one in particular, when I read it, I was like, this doesn't even just seem bad. It seems like they were flat out lying to them. Yeah. Like, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, because I think you like, I mean, I think you usually think that stuff like that just happens on like television programs and stuff. But yeah, I mean, I guess it's like, in any profession, there are people that are good at their job and people that are bad at their job. And in any profession, there's also moral people and immoral people. And then I guess really it's almost like the luck of the draw, who's going to get assigned to what case and stuff like that. And if you've got like maybe either like incompetent people or immoral people, or like a combination of both, do you know what I mean? Then it's more likely that this sort of thing's going to happen.
Yeah. You know? It's so frustrating because you almost feel like at the mercy of something like that as well. Like, if, especially if you're in a situation where, you know, it is like, I'm reliant on whatever these people can do to help, or, you know, and then you're just like, oh my God, like, all right, nothing.
Yeah.
Sound.
The thing is like, if that was your daughter or if that was like your girlfriend or whatever.
Yeah.
What I mean?
Then like you'd be like, how? Like, yeah.
What's being done about this? Oh, we're handling it, man.
Even like
we're
with the Watcher, you know, when you're getting all those letters and your life becoming ruined, you're becoming financially ruined and all of that stuff. But the police are just a bit like, yeah,
almost
sorry,
that's like it's not a big deal.
We'll go past your house a couple of days, couple of times a night and stuff.
We'll look
and,
into it when we get a chance.
But I imagine if that's you, you'd be like so frustrated. Yeah. Like, I just need every resource, and that you have to hire your own investigators.
And you almost like expect that like the police would take it real seriously. But if they're being really wishy-washy about it, you're like, whoa, I didn't really expect it to be like that.
God damn it!
God damn it!
God damn it!
Sometimes I've flirted with the idea of becoming a detective. I think they often work nights.
Yeah.
And yeah, I just think it would be really, I mean, the same reason I really like mysteries and stuff anyway. I would be interested to like look into it all and then like to like drive around and like knock on doors of people's houses and try and piece it all together. You
know what
I mean?
You'd have the brains, but then you'd also have the muscle.
Well,
to go around and be like, you know.
And quite cool flashing a little badge.
Yeah.
FBI.
Should look into it, man.
Detective Obadiah. On the case.
You'd have your Obadiah penny whistle with you.
Yeah. This is my penny whistle.
That could be your undercover name.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Detective Penny Whistle.
Yeah, man, that's fine.
Known, and then it's like you know how like with Batman and stuff, he's got like a little symbol. You just like, if anybody ever wants me, they just blow a little whistle and then I just appear. Like a little old-fashioned little metal whistle. Can you picture the one I'm thinking of?
Yeah, man. Mm.
And then there's like a streak of lightning, and then all of a sudden I'm just there in the rain. Yeah.
You gold.
Yeah, you like doing the Batman voice as well. So
oh,
like,
mate, I'd love it. I'd ham it right up. Yeah.
What is noted in these reports, however, are the contents of Jeanette's purse and the revelation that it was apparently never recovered, despite previous accounts given to us by responding officers on that day. So once again, like, apparently the purse never got found, but the police were like, yeah, we got it.
Mm.
You know?
Oh, right. That's weird.
Approximately 8 feet south of Jeanette's remains were the contents of her purse, apparently dumped out into one small pile. Listed in the evidence reports and shown in corresponding photos are a pack of Markle tissues, a Vicks inhaler, a small compact lipstick, a comb, a key on a ring, and a clear vial with an unknown substance, which her mother has come out and said that she had a mild cold, so it was like something to
I like how she made her own elixir.
Yeah. That's she said it was resembling a coricidin bottle. Coricidin. Coricidin. I'm not sure what that is. But
probably just some type of American sort of cold mixture. You know what I mean? You know how we would have our own different stuff. I know that some of the things in America are named slightly different over here. You know. But they're essentially the same product. Right.
Soccer.
Like soccer. Football.
Pivwalk.
I think they might call paracetamol. I think they might have a different
paracetamol.
Have you heard of what is it that America cocodamol and stuff like what's that?
Cocodamol's codeine paracetamol mixed together, like you get codeine.
Oh, so you can get
it's like cough syrup, right, or something.
Yeah,
cocodamol's like a stronger painkiller.
Right. Right.
I'm sure I've heard of certain things though that like, you can only get. what are you laughing about?
I just got this image, right? I remember once I got back to mine when I lived in Cannington still, and Sherelle was like, she'd done something. I can't remember what she'd done, but she was like, she needed some like cocodamol, and and she'd had these cocodamol, but they were really strong.
Oh no!
And like, and she'd had a glass of wine as well.
You say it was codeine and paracetamol.
Yeah,
that's so really strong.
Yeah. And like, so she and I remember I was like downstairs, and she had this bottle of wine, or she was a bit drunk or something. And I remember I went upstairs, and she was like, she was on the bed, but with her ass sticking in the air, and just on her face, and just completely asleep. It was like.
Sparked
and then I woke her up because I was like, it's a bit dangerous, and she's like completely like delirious because she was a bit drunk and like on codeine.
And on, yeah, and on all the codeine and that.
Yeah.
Wow, nuts. That's hilarious, man.
What is absent, however, is Jeanette's purse itself, along with any money or a wallet. If Jeanette was murdered, it is now apparent that the killer took her purse and her cross necklace too, possibly as souvenirs.
So it seems almost like in that regard, almost like it's not just a murder, it's like a petty crime in terms of like,
like you know, they were getting financial gain out of it.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean?
That's what it seemed to me when I
do you know what makes, do you know what I think a fantastical theory?
Mm.
The fact that obviously she had that little vial. What if it wasn't Corsair? What if Ooh. She was a witch? Mm. And it was like some hate crime against witches or something by like some fanatical witch hater.
Mm.
Yeah.
Watch out, witches.
Mm. The devil's
some teeth. Like big fan of the Salem witch trials or something, do you know what I mean?
Mm.
Did they ever find the homeless man that lived in the woods there?
Yeah, I think they found him.
They found
and
him.
And they literally were just like, oh, was it wasn't like him. Just spoke to him.
Was it you?
No.
No. Oh, all right, cool.
Yeah, it's there seems literally to just be like no leads like whatsoever from pretty much everything I read. Like that was like the only seeming lead.
Oh, I mean, I don't know how
like was the police.
I don't know like what area of New Jersey did you say this was, or did you not say? Is this actually in like this? Is this?
I'll double check.
Because New Jersey is a state, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah.
But then, so it's a
Springfield.
Springfield,
Hudell's Collie, which I assume is in Springfield.
Yeah, like, I don't know how populated this area is. I mean, obviously, this is back in the early 70s, so I'm sure there wasn't anywhere near as much CCTV today as there is today. Mm. I mean, but
I think it was meant to be like a really safe area.
Yeah, surely somebody would have seen something. Mm.
That's what I thought, yeah.
I think what's so like random with things like this is like there is like kind of like random crimes that just happen, or it's like, you know, it's a one-off that person is like can see an opportunity, take the opportunity, do it, and then it's almost harder to it's like that one that you did about that family that all got killed and everything at the ranch, or was it, you know?
Oh, Bullwinkle.
You know, and it was almost like quite out of the blue and quite like random act of violence, cruelty, all that stuff. So it makes it even harder to investigate, because there's no like passion behind it. It's not like a crime of passion. It's you know, they've got this whole backstory.
It's not premeditated.
So someone could just randomly do something, and then it's like, you know, no one will ever get the truth, because only that one person would have ever known or seen about it. What was that other one as well, that with the kid in the forest? Did he ever get
Dennis Martin?
Yeah.
Poor little Dennis.
Yeah, poor little Dennis, with that guy who was like seen like running with it. Yeah.
But then other people said it was like a bear.
Yeah.
And then it was like, was this some weird bear man?
That was a cool one.
A werebear.
The werebear.
But it's stuff like that. It's like random. Just random acts that are just out of the... Like,
and he apparently... He hadn't even like wandered very far, but then just disappeared off the face of the earth. And like to this day...
Like snatched.
To this day, they just never found his remains or anything.
Mm.
Mm.
That was crazy, that one.
Yeah.
That was a crazy one.
So they found like the person, the necklace were missing, like we said. Probably just got stolen, to be honest. Obviously, the release was monumental. Like this whole thing that got released in 2021 was huge to like all the family and friends and everything that have been like following the case for decades, trying to figure out actually what happened. But yeah, it looks like there was pretty much no occult element to Jeanette's death. And the only questions that really remain is how did the police even sincerely whatsoever believe that there was any kind of occult element to the case?
Like, why did they say it? Was it just fobbing everyone off?
Stop fobbing.
Why
Stop
did so many police off. Officials insist for almost half a century that Jeanette's case file and evidence had been destroyed in 1999 by flooding? And, of course, the question still remains of who actually killed Jeanette Depalma.
Well, seems a bit iffy with the police force. Like, either they had something to do with it, or they knew that they'd covered it up by saying those things because they couldn't be bothered. So, like, you know, it's like hiding either of those two things. Mm. Like, why else would you do it, you know?
Yeah.
Either they were just really, really like incompetent and lazy.
Or there's a more sinister.
Yeah. Or maybe it makes you wonder if, you know, if they knew, you know, it was like they knew who'd done it, but maybe the person that done it had like
crazy Barb from the police force.
Yeah, do you know what I mean? Like had some were in power or something. Like I just watched this really good programme called The Devils in Ohio.
Oh, what's that?
Which is a really good like Netflix show. It's like a one off series sort of thing. Really good. I recommend watching it. But then it's like that's a bit like that. I don't want to give obviously away any more than that, but it's like it becomes evident that they're like very, very, whoever's doing this bad stuff is like very powerful, and then there's like this detective in it, and it's like he realizes that his chief is probably getting paid off sort of thing, and then it's like he's like, whoa, can't, do you know what I mean, like, don't have it, like, who the hell do I trust?
Yeah,
it's pretty cool,
pretty creepy.
Yeah, man.
Pretty
but creepy. Anyway, rest in peace, Jeanette Depalma, poor lass. Hopefully one day we will know who killed her, and you know, maybe like a motive or anything. Probably won't know. No. Let's face it. At this stage,
but to be fair, probably won't.
I mean, it's been half a century, man.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a long time,
long old time. Long old time.
Person could be the person who did it. Could be long gone by now.
Mm. Or they could be listening in.
Or they could
now.
Be in this room.
No, I'm the oldest person here, and I was only born in January
1990. Oh, yeah, good point, actually. Very good point.
I was minus 18 when I did it. I was just a sperm in my prepubescent father's ball bag. Yeah. My 12-year-old father's nutsack. But yes, on that note, everyone, we hope that you have a great week, and we shall see you back next week once again. For some more Mystery Mondays. It'll be Drew's turn once again. Oh, what will Drew bring you, and what will we have in store for you all? No one can truly say.
It's a mystery.
Have a lovely week, everyone. Be safe. We shall see you once again. Farewell.